Satan no more hath dominion, for more than conquerors we are. Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in his wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace.
His love shall not fail you, he promised. Believe him and all will be well. Then go to a world that is struggling, his perfect salvation to tell.
Whoever you are, singing with us.
Oh,
turn your eyes upon Jesus. Oh, turn your eyes. Look full in his wonderful face, and the
hello, friends. We are so glad that you have joined us on this Sunday morning to worship together in community. My name is Laura.
I'm Vaughn.
I'm Lizzie.
I'm Alex.
And we'll be your worship leaders this morning. Let's continue in song together.
When I wake up in the morning, love, and the sunlight hurts my eyes, then something without warning, love, bears heavy on my mind. Then I look at you, and the world's all right with me. Just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day.
Lovely day, lovely day, lovely day, lovely day, lovely day,
lovely day. When the day that lies ahead of me seems impossible to face, when someone else instead of me always seems to know the way, the way, the way, then I look at you, and the world's all right with me. Just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day.
Lovely day, lovely day, lovely day, lovely day.
the day that lies ahead of me seems impossible to face. When someone else instead of me always seems to know the way, then I look at you and the world's all right with me. Just one look at you and I know it's gonna be a lovely day.
Hello, beloved community. I hope you are doing well this February day. I miss you dearly, and I'm holding space for you continually in my mind and heart. And I want to say to you, whether you are here every Sunday or this is your first time, that whoever you are, wherever you are on life's journey, whatever your story or identity, God's grace is here for you, and so are we. So we welcome you to the Mosaic Worship Community at First United Methodist Church of Denton. This month, we are partnering with Denton ISD to provide meals for students who are at risk due to food insecurity. No student should have to worry about having enough food in the midst of a global pandemic, and we can help. Please consider giving to communities and schools of North Texas. This year, they're asking for gift cards for individual families that you can drop off at the church office, or you can donate directly by visiting fumcdenton.com/give and write mission in the memo line. Thank you for supporting your community in their time of need. Your generosity, it always comes back. So give freely if you have the means. And before I forget, I wanted to remind you to go get some supplies so we can take communion together today. Some people call it the Lord's Supper. We can't be together right now, but we can still experience God's grace because the Spirit works wherever we are. So grab some juice and crackers and join us later in the service at the table. We would also love for you to sign in today by visiting fumcdenton.com/sign-in. We love knowing you are here with us, building hope together. So let us continue being in the business of hope and love.
Runs to the ocean side.
Today we're exploring forgiveness and how that shapes our relationships. I think that this is a topic that at first glance seems so simple. I just need to forgive people. That's it. But it can so quickly become more complicated. What about forgiving people who have done true evil, who have hurt and abused us or the people we love? Do we have to forgive them too? And I think that's when we really have to examine our definition of forgiveness. Personally, I don't think that forgiveness means saying that the wrong that has been done is okay. I think it's something more along the lines of releasing someone else's actions from ourselves, from our minds, untethering that burden of hate or hardness from our hearts. And I think it's important to consider power differentials when it comes to forgiveness. If we are in the position of power, perhaps it is our obligation to forgive more than if we are in a powerless position. See what I mean? It can get complicated. So as I was thinking of what to say this morning, I turned to our verse for today, Ephesians 4:32. I read a few different versions, and a phrase in one version stood out to me. Be kind to one another, tender-hearted. Tender-hearted, having a tender heart, soft, gentle, easily moved. That word brought a different idea of forgiveness to mind for me. I think if we have a tender heart, we can see from others' perspectives. We can understand their motives, possibly even understand the reasons they have hurt us. Maybe that is when we can find peace. And maybe that is the point of forgiveness, to find peace. Will you pray with me? Creator God, this morning I come to you in search of softness, gentleness. My heart feels hardened, and I know that this is not the heart that you gave me. So God, I unclench my fists now in your presence. I release the hold I have on these thoughts of hate and fear and distrust. I open my heart to whatever you may place upon it. May I see with new eyes. May I hear with new ears, quick to listen. May my heart soften and be slow to anger. May my neighbor know tenderness because of me, kindness and gentleness because of me. May I forget every previous encounter when I am with someone, holding no record of wrong. And because of all of these things, may I know peace. If you have a prayer of petition or thanksgiving, or if you have a prayer that can't even be expressed in words, lift that up with your voice or in your heart here now.
Before, moved by the sound of
Hello, friends. I'm Pastor Don Lee. Welcome to worship on this high church holiday, Super Bowl Sunday. Go Chiefs! My thanks to Will Atwood, our ministry intern, for bringing the message last Sunday. And I'm so grateful to you for your support of his learning process. FUMC Denton has a long history as a teaching congregation. I speak from personal experience. You continue to deepen both my understanding of grace and what it means to be the church. Also, a big thank you to the many of you who supported our youth missions fundraiser last Sunday. Our youth raised $2,500 for missions. After recovering from COVID-19, my grandma Coco received her first dose of vaccine. Now the assisted living facility she's called home for several years is asking her to move out. It's not the first time my grandma has experienced a perceived betrayal, having been stripped of her rights as an American citizen and imprisoned with her two young daughters at Heart Mountain during World War II. A sense of betrayal. We all know what that feels like. If the relationship survived, it's only because of a fundamental Christian moire: to forgive. This morning, we embark on a two-week series on forgiveness titled, The Only Way Out. Our scripture reading is from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 31 through 32. Listen for the word of our Lord.
Our scripture reading this morning is from Ephesians chapter 4, verses 31 and 32. Put away from you all bitterness and wrath and anger and wrangling and slander, together with all malice, and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ has forgiven you. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Betrayal. It's something we've all experienced at some level in our lives. Whether a betrayal fed by the pandemic with its restrictions, perceived government overreach or underreach, inadequate vaccines or PPE, unfulfilled promises, a divisive election, partisan politics, fake news, the death of black people at the hands of police officers, the desecration of our capital fueled by rhetoric, churches that have closed their doors, denying us the practice of religion. Checked any of your boxes yet? A person or entity we thought we could trust has let us down, leaving us feeling betrayed, frustrated, hurt, or angered. But, argues the Apostle Paul, God doesn't intend for you and me to live like this. He writes, "Forgive one another as God in Christ has forgiven you." In other words, forgiving is the only way out. There's a wonderful story about forgiving in the Jewish Torah, our Old Testament. Maybe you know it. Joseph is betrayed by his own siblings and sold as a slave. After 11 years of slavery, he's imprisoned. Dude, could things get any worse? Apparently. Joseph is only freed after interpreting Pharaoh's dream about an approaching famine. He's then entrusted with filling Egypt's storehouses with enough grain for the nation to survive a seven-year famine. If we had known COVID-19 was coming and had 7 years to prepare for it, imagine where we'd be today. I'd be in Aruba, I'm just saying. When Joseph's own brothers show up to secure food and don't recognize him, he plays along. Joseph was 17 when his brothers sold him into slavery, just a teenager, and 30 when he entered Pharaoh's service. He's had plenty of time to work through his feelings about his brother's betrayal. Joseph had lost so much, his family, his home, his way of life. But at some point, Joseph started to see his own complicity in his own story. While what his brothers did was wrong, hurtful, and unjust, Joe had in fact fueled their jealousy and anger by exalting himself over his older brothers, by bringing bad reports about them to their father, by flaunting his father's favoritism. See this? rocking the Gucci. What's dad got you? That's right, nothing. Remember, a good student of the Bible learns to read between the lines. But Joseph also begins to see how, despite his hardships, God has been with him, working to make good out of the bad. In the end, he realizes his brother's misguided revenge had become life for his family and for others. As the Message Bible puts it, "Don't you see? You planned evil against me, but God has used those same plans for my good. As you see all around you right now, life for many people." The Old Testament word used for evil here is ra, and it means hurt, grief, affliction, and evil. Have you ever felt that way? Ra? Joe discovers that the only way out is through. Put away all bitterness, says verse 31. Healing begins when we first name the hurt. Name the hurt. Like grief, forgiving is a process. It takes courage to own your feelings and to share them with others. Name the hurt is moving beyond bare facts to raw feelings. Wounds easily fester when they are ignored. You know, like a dog with a bone, we bury our hurts so that we can revisit them. Tastes good with a pinch of dirt. Name the hurt. Like when Jesus served Judas communion at the Last Supper. "One of you will betray me," he says. Only naming the hurt can make forgiving possible. Only then is love within reach. This story is a reminder of why we practice an open table at communion. A table where even the one who betrayed Jesus is welcome. It makes me wonder who isn't with us at our communion table and what we will do about it. If forgiving is to happen, it's vital we admit our own capacity for failure and betrayal. As Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. once put it, we must develop and maintain the capacity to forgive. He or she who is devoid of the power to forgive is devoid of the power to love. There is some good in the worst of us and some evil in the best of us. When we discover this, we are less prone to hate our enemies. Ouch. It's a lot easier to call out injustice in another than to confront it in myself. Forgiving requires we work to create a world where injustice is not the norm, or to use biblical language, where all realize they are God's beloved. When you name the hurt, you begin to move toward the person who has hurt you instead of moving away from them, making forgiveness and reconciliation possible. Name the hurt. Secondly, relax your grip. Relax your grip. There's been a lot of discussion about a return to normal. I suspect I'm not alone in concluding that whatever normal we return to will not be the normal we once knew. I, for one, will never look at a pack of toilet paper the same way. Come to Papa. I think of forgiveness in these terms, not as a return to what was before, as if it never happened, but to something that is altogether new, perhaps even better, one informed by the wilderness that we've passed through. Relaxing your grip is about opening yourself up to the possibility of forgiveness and healing. One of our church's saints, Weldon Burgoon, owned Weldon Saddle Shop and Western Wear in downtown Denton. He used to tell me stories about his career as a rodeo cowboy. And I've no doubt that he'd say there are times when relaxing your grip makes good common sense, especially when the bronco you're riding has got the better of you. That's a great analogy for the need for forgiveness. In my mind, the question is not, does someone deserve forgiveness? I mean, no one deserves forgiveness. The question is, do we believe in it? And if so, are we willing to do the hard work of forgiving so that the rawness can heal and love become a possibility for our relationships? It's an interesting question. Do you believe in forgiveness? Some would qualify this with, well, it depends on who's asking for it. I'll give you that. But don't you ever get tired of being angry? It's exhausting how much emotion and energy our resentment and anger consume. Part of relaxing your grip involves giving up on our right to get even and deciding instead to leave the scales unbalanced. You may be thinking you don't have it in you to forgive someone. Let me put this plainly. We are empowered by Christ to forgive. I mean, we say that God is with us, but how? When we make the effort to forgive someone, it frees God's Spirit to work towards reconciliation, both within us and within our relationships. The end goal being, can you guess? Transformation. I believe in the forgiveness of sins, says the Apostles' Creed. Nowhere in the creed does it qualify that forgiveness, whether God's or our own. As Jesus teaches, forgive us as we forgive others. Jesus uses two words for sin, aphilema, debts, and paraoptima, trespass. By alternating between these two different words for sin, debt, and trespass, Jesus broadens its meaning. A debt can have both monetary and spiritual value, and a trespass can have both behavioral and theological implications. Jesus' disciples seek to forgive in all aspects of their lives and relationships, financial, emotional, relational, and spiritual. Forgive as God in Christ has forgiven you. The Lord's Prayer is part of a larger collection of Jesus' teachings about prayer embedded in the Sermon on the Mount. Its theme, the kingdom of God on earth. Basically, it describes how Jesus' disciples are to live within it, forgiving. As the saying goes, the only way out is through. In Matthew 18, Jesus tells a story about a debtor who is forgiven a huge debt, only to refuse to forgive a much smaller debt owed him. The forgiven debtor is thrown into prison for his lack of mercy. Note Jesus' choice of metaphors. When you refuse to forgive someone, you become imprisoned by the very thing you believe gives you some measure of control over them. You become a prisoner of your resentment. But when you relax your grip on the rawness you feel, healing begins. We humans have this huge capacity for forgiveness that goes untapped when we unfriend those who hurt us. I'm curious, do the people you most look up to hold grudges? Mine don't. They've learned to be kind and to forgive. Relax your grip. Forgiving is how we heal, renew, and reclaim our identity as God's beloved. Name the hurt. Relax your grip. Remember, the only way out is through. Forgiveness may be the most difficult thing Jesus asks of us. Thank God for grace. And grace awaits you here at the communion table. Here in the sacred act or sacrament, God's love and grace become concrete. Next Sunday, The Only Way Out, Part 2, telling a new story. For your homework, I invite you to take a walk in some green space and look for a small rock. Hold it in your hand, and as you walk, name the hurts you are feeling. If possible, say it out loud. Then, when you have exhausted your list, open your hand and let the rock fall to the ground and move on. Or if you have someone in your life who is your rock, name your hurts to them. Remember, the only way out is through. Pray with me. Reconciling God, teach us to forgive, to name our hurt, and to relax our grip. We pray this in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen.
Hey again, friends. It's now that time where we gather our supplies, juice, crackers, or whatever we have on hand at home to experience the grace of God together in a tangible form. The founder of Methodism, John Wesley, believed that in taking communion, the bread and the cup that we normally share together is how we actually experience the grace of God. In that moment, when we take the bread and drink the cup, is the moment where we remember that God is active and present in our lives, whether we realize it or not. The Spirit of God is there for us to come at any time and drink from the well of love, to replenish our spirit with a knowing that we are deeply loved by this holy power. We are held. And even through the hills and the valleys of life, and we know the valleys always come, we are not immune to them just because we believe in God. But because we believe in God, we are held through them. Despair, victory, bad luck, a great love. In this life, we feel all of them. The difference as people of God is we carry that grace with us into our life, and we know that we are never alone. So let us come to the table together in community, in relationship, in love, and in grace.
On the night in which Jesus gave himself up for us, he took the bread, broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, he gave thanks to you, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us pray. God, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in his final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. And so we pray as Jesus taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." You may now partake in the elements of bread and juice, the body and blood of Christ.
The same for the saint and for the sinner.
from the creation to the cross, there from the cross into eternity, your grace finds me. Yes, your grace finds me. There in the darkness, knock up the soul.
We come now to our time of offering, where we give back the gifts that God has bestowed on us in fulfillment of God's kingdom. You can give by going to fumcdenton.com/give, or you may send a check to the church. Your generosity supports the vital ministries of this church in this community.
Hey, church family. My name is Crystal, and I'd like to share some upcoming opportunities to connect here at the church. The season of Lent is just around the corner, and I'd like to share with you a couple of opportunities to connect during this important time. Our Director of Worship and Music, Josh Taylor, will be leading a church-wide Lenten study on Sunday evenings beginning February 21st. We'll explore together how God is all around us at work in ordinary people, through ordinary situations, and visible in ordinary things. Visit fumcdenton.com/groups to learn more about this opportunity and to sign up. Also, Ash Wednesday is coming up, and there are two ways to participate this year. On February 17th, you will be able to swing by the church for Ashes to Go between 7 and 8 a.m., noon to 1 p.m., or 6 to 7 p.m. Just drive up, pray with a pastor, and receive your ashes for self-imposition this year. We will also be offering an online service that night at 7 p.m. If you would prefer to join us online, you can pick up ashes at the Mulberry Street entrance beginning next Sunday at noon. You are also welcome to use any other household item like glitter or dirt. As with all things this past year, Ash Wednesday will look a little different, but it will still be a meaningful gathering to begin the season of Lent in our community. Also, if you'd like to learn more about who we are, please visit us online at fumcdenton.com/beliefs.
If you're interested in becoming a member, we invite you to visit fumcdenton.com/membership.
I invite you to receive this blessing. Friends, let us reclaim our identity as God's beloved children, naming our hurt and relaxing our grip, and in the process, healing ourselves and renewing our relationships. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.
When I wake up in the morning, love, and the sunlight hurts my eyes, then something without warning, love, bears heavy on my mind. Then I look at you, and the world's all right with me. Just one look at you, and I know it's gonna be a lovely day. To face when someone else instead of me always seems to know the way, then I look at you and the world's all right with.